Welcome back, everyone. I'm Just Saying, and with me here is Sixo, and we are casting the deciding match of Group D between Hoi and Tice. One of these players will move on to the top eight, and one of these players will be sent home. Will not advance to one of you, so, but it's a seat story.
Yeah, yes. In the group, Oskaka won it. Ignite just lost against Hoi, so Hoi and Tice already played in the first game, so it's a rematch. The last match was decided by four Tusker Totemics rolling four Totem Golems.
Yeah, Tice did roll a lot of Tusker Totemics and got a lot of Totem Golems. In this series, hopefully he is not as lucky as pretty one-sided the first time. But again, Hoi does not ban Tice's Shaman, so that will be open again. Instead, Hoi has banned Tice's Druid, and Tice has banned Hoi's Warrior. So with the Warrior ban from Tice's side, I think we can assume that Tice's Warrior is the OTK Warrior. He wants to avoid C'Thun Warrior at all costs. So Tice has left is Rogue, Shaman, and Warrior. And Hoi has Druid, Shaman, Warlock. What do you think of the matchups?
So, I mean, since most people prepared for Zoo, I'm pretty sure that most people don't know how they match up against Hoi's Reno Lock. Especially since I don't think anyone practiced against the Goth Reno Lock. But yes, the Goth could be good against Rogue if you...
Yes, the Goth somehow slithered into Hoi's deck, and it's been a very... very powerful attack, right?
He for sure put in there to beat the OTK Warrior because they don't have an answer for it.
Yeah. It's so almost like impossible,
usually,
right?
At 30 HP, you are not but safe because with the Faceless, they have more than that. But if they have to use one of their Chargers to run into Corkwon, I mean to run into Sogoth, the other one can't OTK anymore.
Right.
So.
Yeah, because the Sogoth will soak the whole Worgen, right? And the Worgen dies.
Yeah, so it's like with Faceless, you could have two, but one doesn't deal 30 damage.
Right. So the max that they do is 26 with the remaining Faceless.
Yeah, with the remaining Worgen. Everything reduced and can save everything. Sometimes they have to use like a Task Force on NRH earlier.
Right. Well, hopefully. Does it ever get to that point? Where the Sogoth really just stops the deck, or is the deck too fast?
No, that happens.
Okay. Well, that'll be a very interesting match.
That's actually
to see.
How we won against Lothar in the first group stage. It was 2-2, that matchup. And Lothar had like basically everything reduced, but used one Inner Rage earlier, so he only had 22 damage.
Oh.
And like he had 44 damage, but one of the...
Right, and the Sogoth eats one and
Sogoth,
22.
And was at 26 HP. Oskaka was careful, and Oskaka thought that Doth had a way to save the Inner Rage and go for 26 burst instead and would have won that. I don't know if there was a case, but...
Well, I would trust Oskaka's opinion on that matchup, since Oskaka also brought the OTK Warrior. And he's done very well. He's already advanced out of this group, actually, playing it as well. And I think he 3-0'd Ignite a few rounds ago with it, too. So is there any read on the rest of their decks? Are they able to go to games? Okay, so we are starting off with game one, finally.
We see Tice playing his Totem Golem Shaman.
His Totem Golem Shaman. So what do you think of this matchup?
Wait. It's a mid-range Shaman. I think it's quite heavily favored for Druid. I think most people would call it somewhat even or not sure about it, but I actually think it's quite heavily favored for Druid.
I mean, the way I see it, Druid has ramp, and that's very important in the mid-range matchups. Druid also has two nourishes, and you're playing a mid-range versus mid-range matchup where the Shaman doesn't exactly have a whole lot of reliable draw.
Yeah, it's like Shaman with a lot of cards, Shaman gets out-tempoed, and... Yeah, no, it's like, it doesn't really feel like Druid has any interaction that goes like, it's like super good against Shaman, it just feels to be the better deck.
Yeah. The Shaman's only real option is to get in the damage early and tempo out with Hex, and hopefully deal enough to the Druid before the Druid finds its real stride.
Yeah, but when was the last time you've seen mid-range Shaman get an early kill?
Well, I mean, look at Tice's hand.
Yeah, but there's no lava burst you can draw into.
Yeah, but I mean, you have the dream here. You have Tunnel Trog, Totem Golem.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, definitely.
Flame Tongue Totem. This is very, very strong.
Hand.
Yeah.
That's a good card, I think. So I'm pretty sure you go Coin White Growth here. Gives you the option to Living Root Zero Power next turn to kill the Totem Tunnel Trog.
Yep. Just an efficient usage of your mana.
I mean, you basically use the coin to kill the Tunnel Trog, right? Because if you pass the turn, go Wild Growth on turn 2, like, turn 4.
Yeah, yeah, you don't have a good turn to fit in the hero power if you don't use the coin now.
Like, if you had a Wrath, then you could, like, go for the Dream, go for, like, a Living Woods now, just for 2-1 ones, then go Wild Growth, and then go Coin, Nourish for Mana, and Wrath, but since he doesn't have a hand that supports Heavy Ramp, he probably would have to use a Nourish for card draw, unless he draws some big minions.
This hand, I would be very hesitant on ramping for mana, considering you just don't have any of the minions that you want yet. But if Hoi is running, like, Cenarius and Onyxia, a bunch of the heavier threats, then I guess it's always fine. In that case, I think that build of the deck, you always go for mana. But,
I mean, do you really always, like, even, like, sure, you have a high chance to draw into one of them, but it's not that high. Like, if your hand is really just, like, we see Savage Roar and Milch, and like, it feels really bad to go for mana if you don't have at least an Azor Drake on hand.
I mean, with either version of the deck, Hoi has found himself in kind of a bad spot at this point. Like, when is he going to find enough time, really, to get this Nourish off? And this is the kind of hand that Tice wants. A whole lot of pressure early on. And especially with Hoi having such a bad hand as well.
Yeah, Hoi just casted Conceal.
Ah, yes. Hoi
has a pretty good tech in Mitch Druid.
Yeah, Conceal is very, very strong. I think we have him back now, yeah? Very good.
I think we just Flame Tongue here.
Flame Tongue?
I like Flame Tongue. On turn 4, Druid can't really deal with it.
Yeah, but you can Totem and go double Flame Tongue next turn.
Yeah, but if you get Searing Totem, you cry against Swipe.
Yeah, but this is your 25%.
But I mean, just Flame Tongue into second Flame Tongue. I don't really see the upside of using a normal hero power here instead of Flame Tongue.
Well, the upside of making the Totem is you can just trade off the Totem next turn if he plays Mire Keeper. Right? Like, the other way you do it, it becomes a little awkward if
your
opponent plays
a minion. But I mean, if you Mire Keepers, you still just go for a second Flame Tongue, Abusive, all your minions go face and you walk better down the Mire Keeper. I don't think that's, like, really a concern.
Swipe comes down from Hoi.
So you see.
Are you ready for the Totem Golem?
You see Tice pick up a 3 mana, 3-2, plus 3-4.
Well, certainly you couldn't roll another one. Tice has already rolled, I think, 4 in a row at this point. Oh, is it?
Only a Flame Tongue. That's unlucky.
That's pretty good. Well, I feel very bad for Hoi, based on the amount of well rolled totems on Tice's side.
Yeah, Ignite adds a roll to Totem Golem against Hoi in the last series, so Totem Golems have been pretty mean to Hoi today.
Yes.
I mean, not Totem Golems.
You put this Abusive in between the Tuskar and the Flame Tongue, yes?
So your opponent turn 5.
Yeah,
so you might expect like an Azor Drake and you want a 4-1.
Right. And if he ever happens to hero power, he might have to take the 4. Wow, Hoi's hand is very miserable. What do you do here, 6-0? What's the line to come back in this game?
Mm. Usually with those hands, like, just look at his hand.
Yeah.
You want to go for Nourish for card draws, and you can Empo and reduce a lot of cards, and then on turn 7 try to get board.
Oh, but you're already
but
taking
with
9
this
damage.
Board,
yeah.
You won't have 2 turns to do that.
Yeah.
So I don't think he has a winning line, so he probably will just mulch the Flame Tank Totem, Hero Power Down, the Abusive Sergeant.
Right. And next turn you can Raven Idol for Starfall or something and try and get a winning play through that. Yeah, things are looking very grim for Hoi. And while Tyze's hand is only damage at this point. And you were telling me that you haven't seen mid-range Shaman be very aggressive.
Yeah, well, I guess if you have three Flame Tank Totems, you can play quite aggressive.
Yeah, it's one of the cards that works fairly well in combination. Wow, aggressive Shaman.
You might. I think Tyze plays a Stormquake in his Shaman, so you can play Chrom and activate it with a Stormquake on turn 10.
Of course he does. Wow, I mean, so you just double Flame Tongue and play the thing? And yeah.
The second Flame Tongue doesn't really do much.
Okay, so now you're not willing to play the Flame Tongue. Okay. Yeah, I would Totem too, I think.
So like if you play one Flame Tongue first, and then on the second time play the second Flame Tongue, you allow your first Flame Tongue to attack as well. That's why I like the Flame Tongue on turn 3 or whenever it was.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, on this turn, just normal Hero Power seems better, since this way more Totems can attack next turn.
Yeah, that's fine. So, the Wrath is a good pickup, at least to get rid of the Flame Tongue. Then you can Raven Idol, try and find Feral Rage or Mulch, maybe even Healing Touch is okay.
Considering, I mean, there's no out that like actually lets you win, right?
Yeah, but it's the best you can do on the 3 mana.
Trying to think of like, anyway. So, that's kind of weird. You can just imagine. But this is actually not the production team's fault or anything. It's even on the client we're spectating Hoi on, it's not shown. So, it's just Blizzard doing weird things. That's out of our control.
Yeah, well, I guess Hoi has a very hard choice here. Maybe he has picked up something worthwhile. Only time will tell. Wow.
Oh, he got to New York!
Okay.
Oh, that's Nisla on board. That's unlucky. Yeah. Wait. That's only 12 damage on board, right?
Mm-hmm.
And he can Hero Power to 13.
After the Astral Communion?
Yeah. You get the mana, actually. So
yes.
You don't get any mana crystals. Empty mana crystals, you get full mana. So you could Hero Power, go to 13, and if your opponent has 0 damage, you can top deck York.
Whoa.
York goes like Flamestrike and Call of the Wild. You have a taunt.
Yes.
So Hoi
was not
that
considering
game.
The outs there, yes.
But we saw Tyze had another Flame Tongue and I think an Abusive Sergeant.
Yeah, what a starting hand from Tyze as well to win that unfavorable.
So, against Duino, do you keep the things from below?
I think they're great.
Yeah, but do you keep them?
I think you can. Okay, if.
I don't think you
do you like
keep
keeping one or do
no.
you like keeping two?
No, I think you never keep one. Either you go for two and then you have to heal upon two and you have to play either. Hero Power or Task for Tamic on turn 3 if you draw it, or you don't keep any. I don't think you want one because like the second one is better than the first one because that way you're more inclined to Hero Power early on.
Oh, he doesn't keep any of them.
Yeah, I think okay. You either keep both or you keep neither.
I definitely like keeping both. You have your turn 1, you have your... they're just great to contest things like Emperor Thorzin as well later on. Yeah, definitely. I would have taken it, but Tyze decides to go for the Taskar Totemic again, yes. Get it out! Wait, you say this is mid-range?
Oh, we saw a double Lightning Storm.
Well, okay, so Tyze bans Hoi's warrior in the matchup. So we have seen lists floating around of Aggro Shaman with double Lightning Storm. If you ban Warrior, it's a little bit better, because obviously the Lightning Storm is pretty bad in that matchup. And with double Lightning Storm, you're teching to beat Zoo a little bit better, and you're teching to beat the Mirror a little bit better. So the Lava Burst definitely makes us classify this deck as Aggro instead. But from what we saw before, maybe we were misled to think it was mid-range.
I saw that Life Coach played mid-range Shaman. It's like Life Coach actually played mid-range Shaman and thought they had the same lineup, so I guess that's why I thought Tice played it.
No, Tice is very sensible and understands that simply we must go face.
Simply we must.
Mm-hmm. Oh, we actually can see the card choices this time.
It's Abusive Sergeant, Mortal Coil, and Stone Tusk Boar.
Let me take Coil. I really do like the Coil take, because your hand right now is fairly slow and you haven't quite found your curve yet, and hopefully Coil can help smooth that out for Hoi.
Yeah, I mean, Mortal Coil does the same as Stone Tusk Boar would do, just that you draw a card, and you don't expect to have a board next turn, so Abusive Sergeant would likely be useless. So...
Yes, Tice.
7 Tusk Dynamics got played against Hoi today.
Mm-hmm.
4 Totem Golems... No, 5 Totem Golems, 1 Flame Tongue, 1 Tusker, 0 normal totems.
Well, this really hasn't been Hoi's best day on the receiving end of RNG. But in this case, it's not too bad.
I mean, it is pretty bad, considering he just gets a free card. Like, you have to spend resources on killing it, and he already got the draw.
Yeah, but I mean, Demon Wrath doesn't do a whole lot in this matchup. And playing it on 3 for this is it's not too bad.
Yeah, just imagine it was like any 0-2 totem or whatever. Then you trade your 2-2 and do the 3-2 and just develop faster, and your opponent has another one card less in his hand.
6-0, it's not that bad, okay?
It's absolutely terrible.
Hoi can still win.
Like, if you... I mean, yeah, he can still win because Tai's deck is teched against Zoo, not against Reno Lock, so...
Yeah.
The tech choice is definitely a Hoi, but...
So
if you compare
early.
This situation to the situation that would have been if it wasn't Mana Tide or Totem Golem, it's real bad.
Yeah, I mean, I understand that.
Actually, no.
Hoi is unlucky,
because
but...
Totem Golem would have been pretty bad. Because if it's Totem Golem, he trades a 2-2 and then Demon Wrestles.
Yeah.
So it's
so Mana
similar,
Tide is like
but
almost
the
best. But
what do you mean almost?
Hmm?
What do you mean almost the best?
Was the Totem Aiden Bowl to attack? You use Flame Tongue. Kill off the 2-2.
Yeah, but then...
Oh, he chooses to go for Lightning Storm. Finally, Tice is a little unlucky here. Only rolls the 2 on the Sun Fury.
No, but if it was Flame Tongue, he kills the 2-2, but Hoi could just play a Farseer.
Oh, wow. This top deck. Would you not have just played Farseer there?
No. He wants to coin Emperor, so he just wants to have more cards in his hand for that as well. But obviously, Doomsayer is really, really handy here, because Doomsayer most likely will go off. You see Tice on 3 mana. There's no way he uses a Lava Burst to remove it.
Yeah, so it's pretty insane.
Get an empty board. Like, the best turn you can have on an empty board is Coin Emperor. You'll never see a better way to take profit off an empty board.
Hoi has played the Sun Fury Protector pretty early on. And as far as defensive measures in his deck, we do see the Farseer. I think he has an Infested Tauren, a Defender of Argus, and no other real natural taunts, correct?
Yes.
Okay.
But he has a Sagoth.
Oh, he also has Sagoth. Slithered into his deck. But at this point...
What he did there.
Yeah. Well, Tyson's hand is very, very aggressive, and it might come to the point where he will find enough burst and still be able to play around Jiraxxus.
Yeah,
very, very aggressive.
At this point, I don't think you can keep... you can deal with the Emperor. I think you have to... I mean, you play the Tunnel Torque because you will never have use for it later,
mm-hmm.
I think, and then play Doomhammer and just get him to 18.
Get on the smart train.
I guess you could just go for Tunnel Torque, remove Emperor with Lava Burst and play a Totem Golem.
Well, Tice really does have Hoi in checkmate by around turn 8, right? As long as he's not overloaded. You have the 2 Lava Bursts and you have the Hunter Hero Power and the Doomhammer Swings to be safe even through Jiraxxus.
Yeah,
so the only real cards.
Reno. That's a Reno in the deck.
Well, yes.
So
I mean, This is the point, right? As your aggressive shaman, you never play around Reno. How can you?
I mean, you kinda can play around by getting your tunnel truck really high. There's no more dark bomb. So if you can stick a tunnel truck and get to like 6 or next turn maybe, if you probably 6 and attack a couple of times, maybe that is a way to play around Reno.
I think your giant tunnel truck plan is worse than playing around the Reno, but...
Yeah, probably, but I mean, he went for it, he didn't Doomhammer the face, and there's merits to either play. Mm-hmm. So, do you just play the Cairn? I think you probably Silence and Farseer.
Yeah, that seems fine. Oh wow, he even draws Rockbiter.
So next turn you want to probably have 6 mana. I guess if you're choosing to never play on Reno from now on, then you don't need to Rockbiter the same turn that you Doomhammer because you won't use its removal anyway. So I guess it just needs 5 mana. So you could overload for 3, but I mean there's no way to overload for 3 anyway. So yeah. No matter what he does, he will be able to play Doomhammer next turn, but Feral Spirits trade really poorly against Hoist Board so far. So he might be tempted to even Rockbiter down a minion this turn if he is concerned about his board, but can he really be? Probably not. He probably has to just hope his damage somehow lines up and kills Hoy.
Yeah, Tice is really assessing the risk of AoE at this point. If this is the case, he should definitely just go. He has determined there's no Hellfire in Hoy's hand.
I mean, Hellfire still kills off the Spellbreaker, but yeah.
Well, I mean, if you make this play, why not just go face with the 3-4?
If you do that, your opponent trades into both your Feral Spirits really efficient. But yeah, I guess at this point you really can't win if there's a Reno.
You can always clean up a Doomhammer. And that is your plan next turn to play Doomhammer anyway. And that's kind of the backup. You can use it to clean up if things go wrong, and if he has the AoE, you'd rather have the tunnel, the Totem Golem alive.
But yeah, so maybe there was no way he really gets punished for going face.
Yeah.
I guess he gets punished by a Shadow Flame. No, he's already saw Shadow Flame, my bad. No, did we? No, we didn't.
No.
It was another game I watched from Hoy last series.
We haven't seen any AoEs yet.
Yeah.
He's even kept that pocket Demon Wrath for a while, too.
Yeah, the last match was the Warlock Mirror Zoo against Reno against Ignite. So that's where the Hellfire happened.
I'm going for Ragnaros here. Well, now Tice is very sure there's no Hellfire. But there's not really much debate anymore.
I mean, the debate is if you use Rockbiter this turn or next turn. I guess turn plays around Ooze, next turn plays around Reno, but yeah, against Reno you don't win, so...
Yeah.
I like this play, even though I want Hoy to win, so I guess I don't like this play. But this sets up for a decent Jirexis turn.
I mean, this also has to go face. Just set up the lethal. Well, as any good Reno player,
Hoy's the best.
Yes, you top deck the Reno just when you need him. Yeah, when Tice sees a life tap, you kind of have to hold your breath a little bit.
Yeah, it's like when they life tap later on in the turn, you think that they just have a bad hand and hope to get Reno, but when they life tap early on without thinking much, you basically know it's Reno.
Yeah. Either that or it's... Well, no, because he could be desperately tapping for Reno as
That's what I said, that if he takes like half a minute before
he
taps.
When he does it so fast.
But yeah, if he does it fast, like, there's no way he decides that he has to YOLO this fast.
Yeah, exactly.
So, Big Game Hunter does get value here. You can remove the...
the Ragnaros.
kind of weird how Big Game Hunter doesn't get the orange border if it's
your activated. Own
mini? I mean, it just never.
It just never over. Gets it right. Yeah. Well, that's really how you nerf a card. You make sure that people don't see its effect at first. So Tice, with this draw, I mean, especially with the build that he has for this tournament, the two Lightning Storms, he's cutting out a bit of damage. I imagine one Horse Rider, one Flame Juggler. So it's a little bit of repetitive damage through minions. It's a little bit of charge damage lost throughout the deck. The overall consistency of finding that burn is just a little bit lower.
Yeah.
And here there happens to be no out for Tice. Yeah. Even with Rock Biter Weapon, he's one off.
That's it. Tice expected people to play Zoo. Like, I think out of 32 players, there's like maybe 3 or so Reno Locks. So he teched this deck against the other Warlock, the Zoo.
Yeah, it's very, very reasonable to tech heavily for the Zoo. Especially when Zoo is so strong in LHS.
Why plays Reno, because people don't tech for Reno since he's the only one playing it in basically every tournament he ever plays.
That is another thing. Hoi is by far the most loyal Reno Lock player, always re-innovating the deck as the meta keeps changing.
Yeah, did you know how many major tournaments Hoi won?
With Reno Lock?
No, actually, how many lands he won so far?
I do not know. Do you have a number?
Two. Divinity and Fire Game.
Oh, wow.
And do you guess what Warlock he played in those tournaments?
Well,
Zoo in both of them.
What is it?
He played Zoo in both
of them. He played Zoo in both of those?
He hasn't won a tournament since he switched to Reno.
Well, he's been the biggest proponent of Reno Lock as of late. Well, Tice, there's not much you can do about this Cairn. So it is going to represent lethal no matter what.
Yeah, think of
probably like just getting ready for the next game at this point.
Like, think if like Storm does anything or there's anything you can do. But
so the Shaman falls. And Hoi gets to keep rolling with Reno Lock. Tice has Rogue and I believe OTK Warrior left. You have more experience with this Warrior versus Warlock matchup, which I believe Tice...
I mean, we would see the Rogue now, because...
The Rogue first, yes.
Tice does know about the Sogoth, so he does know that his Warrior shouldn't be that good against Hoi's Reno Lock, so he wants to get the win with Rogue first.
Yeah.
I have no experience in this matchup. Like, Sogoth Reno against Rogue, I would think that Rogue is decently favored, but... Sogoth is probably too slow, but even without Sogoth, there's been a pretty decent amount of tournaments where the Reno Lock has beaten Rogue. So I think it's somewhat close of a matchup, but yeah, I would consider Rogue favored.
Well, this is more kind of Rogue defeating itself. If it doesn't find Auctioneer on time, it doesn't find its draw engine, then suddenly you're facing off against a deck that just naturally has draw engine through its hero power. And if Hoi has all these resources and Rogue can't keep up, eventually, Tice's losing point is really just Rogue drawing bad.
Yeah, it's
I think other than that, it's pretty Rogue favored.
I don't think it's that Rogue favored. That's just like, I think a lot of the time can come down to a 50-50 Reknos flip on a concealed auctioneer and stuff like that. So I think if you just slightly high roll on your RNG, you have a decent chance to win as Reno, even if the Rogue has a decent hand.
You just told me that the way for Reno Lock to win is with a high roll. So this has to be Rogue favorite.
Yeah,
I said
that the high roll doesn't have to be insane, so I don't think it's like you need to get super lucky. I think just slightly fortunate can be enough.
That's fair. So we rate this maybe 55-ish for Rogue, is what you're saying.
Yeah, maybe up to 60, I'm not sure, but yeah, not more than 60.
Yeah, it's not crazy good, but it's still fairly Rogue favorite. Okay.
But that was without the Sogoth. I really don't know if Sogoth is just too slow, because I have no experience with it. I think it's coming down too late, but I mean, if you get an empty board, even if you're low HP, if you just can forever keep leeway from connecting to your phase, that is huge. So maybe Sogoth does make a difference here.
Well, I think logically, if the game is going that long, Rogue is in a losing spot already.
I mean, that long, like turn 9. The game basically always goes to turn 9.
No, Auctioneer, Coin, go Stealth, set up your turn 7. Can likely be dead before turn 8. Like, you're saying the flip comes down to Ragnos. If the Rogue gets ahead of the Ragnos, they auto-win already.
Yeah, but I don't think the game ends before turn 9 that frequently. You have Reno, you have a couple of AoE clears.
I mean, this is also considering that you draw the Reno.
Yeah, I mean, you're considering the game to end by Rogue having a turn 6 auction into a turn 7 lethal setup. So it's also expecting Rogue to draw well. The issue with this Doomsayer is Hoi doesn't have a way to use an empty board. He doesn't have any like 5 mana minion to play next turn.
Yeah, and Tice has quite the answer already. Do you like using the backstab here? Or how about just the Coin Eviscerate and Edwin?
Do you even remove it?
Yeah, of course.
What do you mean, of course?
Of course you remove it. You have an amazing turn here.
So you... Wait, what? I guess you would...
Like, there is some consideration here, right? Because
no, I think you just Davis. I don't think you backstab, because you can't do this. No. You know that's a big game hunter.
Yeah, I mean, that's the only issue.
I think that 6-6 is good enough here. I mean, we see the hand. We see there is no big game hunter, but that seems really, really risky.
I mean, the assumption is that you can Siphon Soul it next turn, so Tice wants to get in the extra damage now.
Yeah, but Siphon Soul will be too slow. Your opponent plays a 5-drop, you can trade your 6-6 into the 5-drop, and then play an Azotrake, and then if he Siphon Souls your 8-5 or whatever it would be after trading.
Like. Oh yeah, I mean, Tice has given little consideration to the big game hunter here, but what do you think Hoi's play is? You go for the Bane of Doom?
I think you have no option there. I mean, I guess the option is Mortal Coil tap somehow to our big game hunter for next turn, but
yeah,
next
come
turn you
on,
have
Fearsome Doomguard. Yeah?
What
else is there?
Again,
Pit Lord.
I guess Jiraxxus is decent.
Oh, Jiraxxus
especially
is very strong.
No sap, so there could be a taunt on it later on.
Yeah. Oh!
It just kills though. Like, Azotrake, backstab, attack with a dagger into it.
Yeah, if only though. This thing, what is it? It's destroy one of your minions and one of your opponents.
Inspire,
right?
So if you tap, it kills itself. It kills a random minion, but since usually it's the only minion on the board, it kills itself and one random enemy minion.
Hey, that's a pretty good tech against a stealth gadget sand.
Yeah, but I think it's 5 mana.
Six mana, so you can't
do it until turn 8, so you might as well just play back.
Yeah, I don't really trust this Void Crusher.
Oh!
Hello.
I mean, you have to play it.
Mm-hmm.
There's no way you just play Reno here. You do die to Leeway, Cold Flood, but there's little you can do about it. Like, playing Reno now doesn't.
Well, there's that small consideration for Siphon Soul to play around it. But I mean, you will never find another big game hunter against Rogue besides the Cold Blooded minion.
Yeah, it's a 4-2 challenge, it's a 4-4. It's unlikely that it happens, but it can. That's a. I guess he's scared of Shadow Flame, so. I would expect him to play Auctioneer, prep, if he doesn't want anything else, conceal and trade the Azotrake into the Big Game Hunter to play around.
Oh, I fully conceal the board, everything. You play everything by Auctioneer and prep here. You have the reload, you go for the maximum pressure now.
You don't prep. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess it was a prep on hand. You really don't need Auctioneer trap early on. You have a one mana spell and you have prep to get it.
And this line is interesting too. Tice is saying, I'm going to have lethal setup next turn anyway, so if you have the Reno, I would rather go off more with Auctioneer. And he's being very conservative, holding the Cobalt and the Conceal, making his bigger play next turn.
Yeah, I guess Conceal doesn't really do much, realistically.
Mm-hmm.
Like, yeah. There's like a Dark Peddler, PO, Shadowflame, or whatever removal White could have. I guess Hellfire Mortal Coil would be where you get rewarded for concealing. But I guess Tai's play is just correct to save Conceal for Auctioneer.
Yeah. And even saving... I think playing Cold Blood is still fine there.
We have to see Reno, right? There's like no alternative to Reno.
Yeah.
Oh.
What?
What am I missing? Okay.
Oh. You wanted to make the Shadow Flame play this turn. Wow. Well, playing on the edge was not rewarded.
I mean, it kind of was, right? What? Oh, wait, no, he's dead. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I'm thinking, like, if you see Auctioneer Conceal, Auctioneer Cold Blood, we could see a Rag sniping down.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah. So, if he goes for the Reno lock, I mean, for the Reno, he goes to 30, takes 8 damage from board.
Mm-hmm.
With double Cold Blood, that would already be 16. But then he has a Twisting Nether. So. Yeah, I kind of like the Reno just to set up for Twisting Nether the following turn, but I get his point. 9 damage isn't that easy. Sure, there is Leroy, there is one Evis left, or two?
Mm-hmm.
Did he use one?
Yeah, he eviscerated the Doomsayer, yes.
So, one Evis, one Leroy, two Cold Bloods. Decent chance he doesn't have lethal.
Yeah, and he tested for the Leroy and damage the turn before when he had Big Game Hunter and he was dead to it.
Just the issue with that with Heifer's Hoyle's play isn't that he willingly took the chance to die. That's just the risk he took. But if your opponent just plays an Auctioneer, if you then play Twisting Nether, you're gonna die. If your opponent draws one or two spells with Auctioneer, you're very, very likely to die the following turn. So Twisting Nether kind of is low, but you also want to play Reno into an Auctioneer. So... Yeah, maybe he should have played Reno, but we will ask him.
No, I agree. He should play the Reno there, but he's got a read on Tice's hand, right? Because on the 2 mana Tice floated, he didn't play the Cold Blood.
What read does he have? Like, what cards do you think he expected Tice to hold?
He expects Tice to hold the to not hold the Cold Blood.
Yeah, but even if it's just like an Auctioneer, you have to Reno that turn so you can Twisting Nether against the Auctioneer.
Yes.
So that would be an argument for Reno as well. If you don't expect
it. No, I mean, I agree with you. He should be playing the Reno, but yeah, I mean, I'm just trying to understand why Hoy doesn't go for it, and it's because he has this read that Tice doesn't have the damage. He'd rather clear the board and have a higher life total coming into the turn after Reno.
Yeah, but my point is that even if your opponent doesn't have the burst, if you Reno to get to 20 HP 30, but you take 10 damage from board, you give yourself time to Twisting Nether turn after to get board that way. Because you can never Twisting Nether if you don't Reno that turn. You would have to wait until turn 9.
Mm-hmm.
But okay, so that's a pretty good hand from Hoy. This matchup heavily favored for Face Shaman. I think we can agree on that.
Yeah, especially with a hand like this. Well, Tice has to cycle Blood Mage this turn to find a decent spot to go along with Teacher next turn.
Yeah, Tessa has like all the good cards for this matchup, but they just don't work together. Like, he has the SI, but no way to finish minions off with it. He has a perp, he has a deadly but like no 2-mana spell to go with a perp.
Yeah, but Hoy is going to take basically a turn off this turn, and then the Violent Teacher, once you find the spell next turn, can be the big difference in this game.
Come on.
Yeah, it's kind of interesting to me how good Tice's hand can look, but still just do nothing. Hoi is really not sure. The Tunnel Talk doesn't get buffed next turn. Like, you don't want to overload next turn, so you want to overload on turn 5. So playing Totem Golem the next turn gives you a high chance that it sticks around until turn 5. But Argent Squire is weaker to a Fan of Knives turn.
Oh, here comes the fan.
That fan pickup really makes Hoi rewarded for going with the Tunnel Talk over the Squire.
Yeah, indeed. But what is Tice's best line?
I guess you teach a prep fan and attack. Oh wait, no. You have a 3-mana deck anyway. So,
I mean, can you really do this with the SI?
You probably just... If you prep, do you save the fan? I guess you cycle it because you don't have a mana to use it later. Also, using the... Cycling the fan makes you save 1 damage since you face tank the Fabled Spirit instead of the 3 damage. Tunnel Truck. Could consider playing the Fan Cleave now because he can if his SI next turn. But he just doesn't want to take the damage.
Yeah, Tice is playing very conservative here. But I think the 6-6 Edwin is ultimately the line that wins you this game more often. Just because you even drew the Eviscerate for SI next turn. I mean, Cleave was rather important to get out that turn.
It's not a good hand for... I mean, Hoi's hand isn't bad, don't get me wrong, but...
I mean, there's a 5-mana card that generally wins the game alone against Rogues. That's,
yeah, the issue is just
that's
that
a good start.
His hand doesn't line up against the SI right now.
And also, the tables turned a little bit. Hoi did decide to play the Tunnel Trog first, and now the Horse Rider top deck... He's less rewarded, right? With the Squire would have been a little bit better.
Right.
If you wanted to make the trade. To protect the Trog, right? And to go into your Doomhammer turn. And you play it the opposite way. It's a little bit stronger
but
now.
Even if you played the Squire, would you do the trade? I don't think
so. Yeah, you just saw Phantom Knives.
I still don't think you want to do the trade. I think you want to connect
You're protecting the Trog.
Yeah, but the Trog can still die to a spell.
Yeah, but then he's wasting the mana killing the Trog.
Yeah, but that's where you connect damage to the face, and face damage is so good against Rogue.
I mean,
but
you
probably would trade, but I think it's... The difference between this play going face and the other play trading is very marginal.
Yeah, well, Tice is in quite the situation. And he's trying to consider how does he fit his resources together to the point where he can actually push some damage against the Shaman.
Oh, that's... He wants to cold blood now.
Yeah, just cold blood the teacher.
Sure. I was thinking...
I mean, it's not amazing, but...
Yeah, I guess it's probably the best yet. I was thinking about an Eviscerate, Fen Cleave turn, but the Eviscerate doesn't do much because your SI attack to the face doesn't do much, and so the Eviscerate doesn't really help.
Yeah, we're forcing Hoi basically to throw a lava burst at the teacher.
If he Doomhammers, goes face, that is how much damage? 7. You get him to 10. Lava burst is 1 off next turn. If you flame tongue, you get him to 10 as well.
I mean, I'm fairly fine with the Flame Tongue this turn. You're not going
to
find a lot of
room
for it.
Flame Tongue and... I guess you want to Lava Burst, the 7-5?
The consideration for that isn't as good now, because then you can't play the Doomhammer the next turn. Maybe you take some RNG flips with the Flame Juggler. If it lands on the Violet Teacher, you're more than happy, and then you can trade the Squire in as well. But he's going to go with the Lava Burst
you
here and say it's good
already.
Enough.
You said, like, you could just Doomhammer face, and if one of your minions survive, or like has to be killed by the dagger attack, you have lethal next turn, because you're only 1 damage off by going for Doomhammer. So maybe there was a method to just Doomhammer face, hope one of your Divine Shield minions stick around for next turn.
Well, this is just trade, conceal, eviscerate face, Edwin. You're completely off of the Auctioneer plan at this point. You have to get the board control this turn. And
yeah, the question is if you
hopefully find some way to push.
Eviscerate and trade your 1/1 into the Horse Rider or go to face.
Well, you should definitely kill the Horse Rider.
Yeah, I guess so.
You think there's any chance Tyson wants to save this conceal for Auctioneer?
Yeah, I think he will. Just it's not that he wants this Orc to conceal, just that he wants to draw the card. Like, the way he wins the play, Hoi not getting bored and not having burst damage in his hand, that's really what he has to hope for.
Yeah.
So he has to just go for the value play, and if you go for value 6-6 or 4-4 Fen Cleave doesn't really make a difference in this situation. Both don't trade into a 7-7, but trade into anything else.
Oh, it does trade into some
that
other stuff.
That is the best card Tyus could have drawn, but there was no out for him to draw Cycle Enter.
Yeah,
for one mana, there's no prevention of
Doomhammer Rockbiter. Game is over for Tyus.
Unless he plays Feral Spirits in his book, because Feral Spirits.
Yeah, Feral Spirits would be a great top deck here. I mean, that I don't even want to think about that as a rogue card.
Yeah, looks pretty bad with preparation. Or just like preparation, animal companion, Fen Cleave. I guess that's the reason Blizzard didn't give rogue a minion spell.
Yeah, like what if Darkiron Skulker was a spell that summoned the dwarf guy.
I guess it wouldn't make a difference because 5 mana. I mean, it was prep, yeah, but it would still cost 2 mana after you prep, so you don't really use any of your combo turns.
So this is a made up scenario, Sixer. I'm just trying to point out how cool that would be.
Right.
Well, it has come down to the last game. The players will take a quick break, quick restroom break before they come back for this final match. A lot of pressure, a lot on the line. So, Tyson's rogue is gone, so he has left the
OTK Warrior
against Hoi Shaman.
Yeah, that's the OTK Warrior.
As the OTK Warrior, how do you feel coming into this matchup?
I feel like the players are listening to us right now, so I prefer not talking about the matchup. Just,
I mean,
as a caster, I don't want to be involved in mind games.
Oh, okay, sure. Well,
we can talk about the last game. What do you think? Did Shaman go face? Good.
Yeah, I mean,
was it a fun game to watch?
For the most part, yes. I'm very happy when the Doomhammer gets equipped and the Rockbiter comes out and you hear the big swings go to face. But interesting lines. I think for the most part when you play aggressive Shaman, there are many, many lines that kind of lead down to the same path, which is winning. for aggressive Shaman, you can do a lot with your burn damage. You control board and turn that burn damage into repetitive damage from minions, etc., etc. And many of these different combinations kind of still lead down to the same thing. This is just aggressive Shaman being able to push damage very effectively. There's some turns where Hoi could have gone with Doomhammer earlier or not overloaded and try to get that weapon out faster, but overall...
Yeah, that case you would set up an earlier lethal, but give Tyus maybe the opportunity to race with a 7-5 teacher, so he chose to go for a safe play.
Yeah, here we go, into game number 5.
Hoi's hand is, before Mulligan, Argent Squire, Feral Spirit, and Rockbiter Weapon.
Mm-hmm.
So he will probably have to Mulligan the Rockbiter and the Feral Spirit just to get a more aggressive start.
Yeah, I agree.
Thing with OTK Warrior is that the main removal is not Brawl, but is Pyromancer and Commanding Shout.
Yes.
But you need quite a lot of mana to actually clear boards with that. So the early game removal is like, sure, it's still War Axe, Plateau Eco Slam, but as basically any deck, you have to play aggressive. You can't just let them get their combo. So against OTK Warrior, with basically any deck you play, you mulligan for early game minions way harder than in other matchups.
No, agreed. And Tice keeps the Blood to Ichor fairly good. Oh, wow. And even draws double War Axe here. So this is the kind of start that heavily favors Tice now.
Yeah, we see Plateau Eco deal with a Squire and War Axe deal with a Flame Juggler.
Mm-hmm.
So really, really good start for Tice here. This is a huge 50-50. Like, even if he gets the hit, he's still not in a good spot, but if he doesn't get the hit, that would be like almost lights out already.
Yeah, just having the 2-1 round to contest whatever minion that Hoi might be playing later on. Oh, this is a fairly dead draw for Tice. Getting that charge early, I mean, the problem with OTK Warrior in these matchups is they do have quite a few dead draws.
So, I mean, you definitely go for the totem here, but do you play the Abusive Sergeant?
Hmm?
Either way, you would play Abusive Sergeant after using the hero power.
Yeah, let's see if it's Searing Totem first.
Yeah. Hoi doesn't actually consider not playing hero power, it's just that he wants to pretend he has options, so Tice doesn't know that his hand doesn't have any other viable play for turn 3.
Yeah. I mean, at this point, he could have bluffed the Feral Spirits and also hinted at a 4-4 at his hand, or 7-7
yeah.
In his hand. So it's very important to hold off on that turn a little bit.
So that's a pretty clear Luthor pass turn.
Yeah. Get the little guy out there.
Luthor is actually really good against Shaman if it doesn't get killed because it just kills the totems turn by for turn.
I think Tice might even consider hitting the 0-2 here.
I don't think so. Since you have the Luthor and maybe Commanding Shout to cycle, you wanna use your next turn to cycle, not to equip a second War Axe. So probably hero power Abusive Sergeant to trade.
Mm-hmm.
He has the option to Abusive Sergeant first if he wants to get a spell damage shot him back. But he really wants a taunt. So we always see the Rockbiter Commanding Shout with coin and execute. That's huge. What do you think? Do you like War Axe attack to the face and then equip the second War Axe hero power? Because no matter what minion opponent plays, you can always clear next turn with Pyromancer Commanding Shout execute.
Yes, of course. It's a little aggressive to swing the axe though, don't you think?
I think it's correct.
Correct?
Yeah. Because look at your hand, you're kind of committed to the Pyromancer next turn. And there's not much downside, I think. I mean, okay, he's playing on the Doomhammer. Yeah, okay. If the opponent plays Doomhammer, what would you do actually? What's your game plan if you expect your opponent to play Doomhammer on turn 5? What do you want to do against it? Because Pyromancer just gets killed by one swing.
Mm-hmm.
So. But I guess even if your opponent plays Doomhammer, you would still have to cycle your Commanding Shout next turn. And if you cycle it, you might as well play the Pyromancer with it. So yeah, I kind of like attack to face there. The thing is that face damage might seem not that relevant because he plays the more defensive deck, but in the end, he has to win at some point. He has to get the combo off, and the combo isn't always 30 damage, so getting a couple of 4x attacks in can make the difference.
Yeah, but it's a little bit early to swing at the face, I think.
Then he killed an abusive sergeant that most likely he can kill for free with a pyromancer next turn regardless. And the swing to the face is because he wants to use the mana to equip a second war axe, so it's not like you can just not attack.
Well, he's just doing some calculations, trying to figure out what Tice's hand is at this point.
This is no question. This will be Pyromancer commanding shot execute. It's just draw a card, pierce the totem as well. You still have the 3-1 Pyromancer. I can't really play the thing from below here because it just gets traded in by the 3-1 Pyromancer and the War Axe. But he. I mean, he can remove the Pyromancer and play Feral Spirits. But you kind of want to save Feral Spirits to block the Worgen later on. You don't want to use it in the early game if you don't have to. But he might be forced into it. But it's so bad with the War Axe as well.
I agree, you have to save thing from the blow.
I think you play it, just because the other plays are even worse.
You value the spirits higher than the thing?
Yes, because both just block one attack, basically, and... I mean, favorites block two attacks, because they're just two. But I guess it's not as bad as it might look, because he has a lot of birds. If he picks up a Doomhammer, suddenly he can put a clock on Tice. So he's really just hoping to draw the Doomhammer sooner than later.
Yeah, I mean, that is a huge deciding point in the game. Oh, we even see Faceless come up.
I think he wants to develop a minion. Probably the Worgen, because Pyromancer would get killed by Doomhammer.
You mean the Ghoul?
I think you play the Ghoul here.
Okay. I mean, you happen to say Worgen.
Oh. But yeah, you don't play the Worgen here. I mean, if the Worgen survives, like if Face Sharp just somehow doesn't have a
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And then suddenly, this is the all in turn, right?
Wait. Why don't you play Worgen and Rogue? You can just go Raging Worgen, Conceal, and next turn just Cold Blood it, maybe Shiv it or whatever. Backstab activated. Do you think that's viable?
I mean, this is kind of a reason why people are playing the Questing Adventure too.
Yeah, but Questing Adventure goes face for like 10 damage, not for a million damage.
I don't know. A million is a little more than 10. What do you like here?
He doesn't have a spell, like his only spell is charge, and even if it would clear the board, which it doesn't because it's still only two triggers with a coin, it would. You still can't afford to use charge because then you'd have to get board control, which your deck isn't really aimed at.
Yeah, so you want to wait one turn. I mean, the only real clear here uses just too many of your resources.
Yeah, you can't Worgen Pyromancer coin charge. I like the Pyromancer.
I mean, you could do it with the Ghoul if you really wanted to. But
yeah, but no.
At this point, do you really want to use the last swing of your axe? I mean, you're really looking for the spell to go with Pyro, and then you clear anyway. And then you just hold it. He's been very liberal with the axe swings.
Yeah, this is the last weapon attack, yes, in the deck. I guess no more Gorehold or anything.
So yeah.
The OTK warrior.
I mean, he didn't need to swing at that 2-1. And now he's swinging at things that will eventually die to AoE from Pyromancer.
So, how much damage is this? He has 6 mana. So that is 9 plus
counting.
5. 9 plus 5 is 14. You buff your Torg for 4. So it's 14 plus 5 plus 4. That's 23 damage. So he was 7 damage off, if I counted correctly. I like this.
Mm-hmm. Cash in on the extra damage from the Trog. Still hold the Rock Biter for Doomhammer.
Healing Totem is really sick here.
Oh yeah, it's insane.
That's a spell. So Pyromancer, if he Pyromancer, deck trade Pyromancer, either Luthor or Op, the Battle Rage picks up Commanding Shard, that would be probably game, but if you don't get a spell to use, like you need to get an answer for the Trog.
Right, right. I mean, that's just a very easy answer to get. One of the Inner Rages, Cruel Taskmaster.
Yeah, but you only have... I guess you can use both Battle Rages, that means three draws.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. Chances that he gets an answer are quite high, but it's really not guaranteed. It's not insanely high. You have to... Battle Rage, like, Acolyte Coin is just worse than Battle Rage here. I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, of course.
Oh, that's the Inner Rage.
There we go.
He has the coin, which means that he can use a combo without Emperor. So he probably wants to save Inner Rage. So I guess you will see Plateau Echo Pass here.
Yeah, so we are very close to just seeing this combo done without Emperor,
yeah,
right?
Two turns away.
Yeah. So as long as Hoi does not find the Doomhammer, I mean, Tice seems
next
to have
turn,
found
Doomhammer,
a way through
Doomhammer
this.
Doomhammer is too slow now. He needed this turn, because next turn it's not lethal anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess Hoi might just have to pick up the Tauntaun, but he can't even move forward.
And now you can even waste the Cruel Task draw a little bit more. Maybe even find the shield block. And plus you want the Cruel Taskmaster out there to punch off the Taunt Totem as well.
Trying to figure out if there's any out for Hoi, but I can't find anything. Like, even Pirate Spirits and Taunt Totem doesn't seem to be enough.
Shield block. That's the one. Perfect turn here for Tice.
Yeah, that was quite fortunate, and I think that's it.
So who needs Emperor Thorzin in this deck? Just go second, hold the coin somehow against Aggro Shaman all the way until your OTK combo.
Yeah. It seems
well,
to happen a lot.
Well,
so yeah, you can basically cut Emperor from the deck.
Yeah.
That's not enough.
What do you think Hoi will do? I mean, you can't survive.
I mean, you can't expect that, because even if you play around it, he will still just do it, and him just having 2 minutes on board will win him the game. So Hoi can't play around Tice's current hand. He has to hope it's something else and probably just go for an aggressive line here. I don't know, but he's not supposed to play around the OTK on turn 10.
Yeah, of course. I mean, you would have to lose exactly to those four cards. Well, five cards if you count the coin, but...
That's the correct line, probably. Yeah, slightly incorrect. Should have played the Abuser Sergeant on the other side because Taunt Totem will get killed every time.
Mm-hmm.
But that won't punish him. He would have lost that game regardless.
Wow, what a crazy final game, too.
Yeah. He's counting it, but he will figure it out. So, out of three Na'Vi players, only one made to the top eight. Hoi and I have fallen.
And out of G2, we have Tice and RDU.
And Life Coach.
And Life Coach. 3-for-3.
Well, those I lost.
Yes. 3-for-4. What an incredible series between Tice and Hoi.
Yeah, that was our last match of the day. So... Tomorrow we'll see the top 8. I think on the A stream they will probably show the pairings right now, so we should probably go over to the main stream to see what matches we will see tomorrow. But yeah, that's it for today. Hoi and Oskar, no, I mean, Tyson and Oskarka advanced from that group. Probably the favorites, but Hoi was just one game away from making it, so.
Yeah, and what an incredible group. Group D,
yeah.
The group of death, including Tyson, Hoi, Oskarka,
and Ignite.
Well played by all of them, but sadly only two of them advanced to tomorrow.
Yeah, I guess that's it.
Yeah, thank you for tuning in.
I think the last match is still going on. And the last match on the other stream was Nyman against Ekop, so should check that out. Otherwise, we will be back tomorrow on the other stream. The top 8 will probably be on the other stream, so
yeah, see you guys tomorrow.
See ya.
Thank you guys for tuning in.